وايت الكلى مركز الكلى وعنده فيري وايد انترناشونال اكسبوجر ما بين امريكا وفرنسا على سنوات كتيره في البحث العلمي. والنهارده هنتكلم على موضوع ريليتد للمؤتمر بوست ترانسبلانت هايبرتنشن. يعني الدكتور خلاص الدكتور احمد حسن خلصه الريسيبيانت الدكتور احمد علي يتكلم عليه. اتفضل دكتور احمد.
بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الاول احب اشكر كل اساتذتي في قسم الباطنه وعلى راسهم الاستاذ الدكتور ناجي الاستاذ الدكتور حسين. واخص بالشكر دكتور ايهاب وفاء. في الحقيقه دكتور ايهاب من البوست ترانسبلانتيشن هايبرتنشن كانت رساله الدكتوراه بتاعته وقضى عمره كله في الهايبرتنشن. ف يعني اجد صعوبه في تقديم المحاضره بوجود دكتور ايهاب الحقيقه. فيرست اوف اول احب اوري حاجات هيستوريكال. يعني دي الورق الاصلي بتاع اول حاله زرعناها في المنصوره ب 27 مارس سنه 76 وده في المستشفى المنصوره الجامعي قبل مركز الكلى. والتاريخ واضح. دي سكان الاوريجنال بيشنت ريكورد. والحقيقه انا بحب اقدم دي على طول لان بحب اوري ان سنه 76 لما انا كنت في اولى ابتدائي كان الدكاتره في المستشفى البطنه الجامعي ومستشفى المنصوره الجامعي ككل حريصين قوي على تدوين البيانات وكان في ريكوردنج سيستم يعني يمكن احسن من اللي احنا بنعمله دلوقتي. كرنتلي وي هاف ترانسبلانتد مور ذان 2600 ليفينج دونر ترانسبلانت ريسيبيانت اراوند 100 بيشنت بير يير ريجولارلي. And for those who is not familiar with transplantation, I would like to give a brief introduction. احنا في الاول عندنا نعمل دونر ريفكتومي بنشيل الكدني من الدونر وبعدين في مرحله يمكن كل الناس عارفه ان احنا هناخد الدونر كدني and we put it in the transplant recipient. بس في مرحله في النص احنا بنسميها كدني جرافت برفيوجن ان احنا بنعمل ورشة للكدني ببرفيوجن سوليوشن وده عشان نمنع حاجتين الثرومبوزس وبنقلل انسيدنس اوف ريجكشن. وفي كمان مواد بتعمل فازو دايليتيشن. الانترستنج ان الاوبريشن كلها من اول شيل الكدني لغايه توصيل الشريان والفين وحاجه اسمها بنسميها دي كلامبنج ان الجراح يشيل يفتح الكلامب والبلاد سبلاي يبدا يعمل برفيوجن للكدني والكدني تجيب يورين. كل الوقت عندنا الافرج عندنا في المركز بيتراوح ما بين 20 مينتس ل 45 مينتس. يعني العمليه كلها يا جماعه بتاخد ساعه الا ربع. انما كل الشغل في ترانسبلانتيشن في الحقيقه نيفرولوجي في التحضير بتاع العيان ومتابعه العيان بوست ترانسبلانتيشن. It is well known that transplantation is a conflict issue. We have a special medical issue in here. We are conflicting with our surgeons, we're conflicting with our lab people, and HLA tissue matching system, and also our immune system is conflicting between the donor antigens and the recipient immune system. So there is a fight. That fight ends with surgical, sometimes surgical. Problems that reflect on hypertension and immune suppressive medications that may affect also the patient to normal intensive states. As an introduction, arterial hypertension is common in renal transplantation and even in the latest guidelines they classified hypertension prevalence in, after transplantation up to 80% of the patients. So it plays a major role in progression to chronic allograft failure and in the morbidity mortality associated with cardiovascular and cerebrovascular disease. With each increment of 20 systolic over 10 diastolic millimeter mercury, the risk for cardiovascular disease doubles. The benefits of sustained lowering of the blood pressure, about 40% reduction in the incidence of cerebral stroke, 25% reduction in the incidence of acute myocardial infarction, 50% reduction in the incidence of congestive heart failure. I already emphasized on the prevalence. That is with the types of immune suppressive regimen, time after transplantation increased from 30 to 40% in the pre-cyclosporine era to 75 and up to 90% after introduction of cyclosporine. Cyclosporine is an immune suppressive medication that is started in the late 80s and proved to give marvelous results as regards the graft outcome. However, it has many complications, as I will emphasize later, associated with graded increase of subsequent even graft failure after the hypertension. In this slide, I will show you how the in renal transplant biopsy, how hypertension is looked like. We have a marked the second blood vessel in here. We can see the narrow slit like lumen with the methoxylin and leucine. And in the malignant hypertension, in another case, even obsolete arterial supply. And in the benign nephrosclerosis, we see the thickening of the arterial wall by hyaline material. And in another example, benign nephrosclerosis with marked intimal fibrosis, luminal narrowing, and the duplication of the internal elastic. Many causes of post-transplant hypertension, starting with factors related to the recipient, donor-related, as Dr. Ahmed said, transplantation-related, including the prolonged ischemia time, delayed graft function, immunosuppressive therapy, which includes the calcineurin inhibitor, cyclosporine and tacrolimus, steroids, renal transplant artery stenosis, renal outflow obstruction, renal transplant dysfunction in the case of chronic rejection, or now it's called chronic allograft nephropathy, recurrent glomerulonephritis in the graft. To summarize this, we have a renovascular and renobarenchymal hypertension. Renal parenchymal, I would like to emphasize on the rejection and the special medication related to hypertension. At 1 year after transplantation, many risk factors have been identified, including pre-transplant blood pressure level, I meant in the recipient, grafting of the right kidney versus the left kidney, delayed graft function, caused or ischemia, transplantation from an elderly or female donor. Also, in another study, they classified the male sex, recipient age, body mass index, acute rejection, lower global level, the cyclosporine again, and high doses of steroids were exposing to hypertension. When we compare the calcineurin inhibitors, cyclosporine versus the tacrolimus, which started in the 90s, there is decreased effective renal plasma flow, glomerular filtration rate, and renal blood flow with the cyclosporine group, increased renal vascular resistance with the cyclosporine. Tacrolimus proved to have a better graft function and less risk of hypertension, even associated with reduced requirement for antihypertensive medication at 5 years follow-up. Switching from cyclosporine to tacrolimus showed an improvement in blood pressure as measured by the ambulatory blood pressure monitor. To see the mechanism of calcineurin inhibitors and steroids in the post-transplant hypertension, as has been discussed by Dr. Mahmoud, calcineurin inhibitors, they have a sympathetic activation, which lead to vasoconstriction, as well as upregulation of endothelin 1, as well as inhibit the nitric oxide and alter the prostaglandin synthesis, which lead to vasodilatation inhibition, both lead to both the renal transplantation hypertension. The vasodilatation inhibition also can be as a side effect of steroids, as well as the sodium retention. All of this would lead to reduced GFR. Reduced GFR lead to the activation of angiotensin 1, angiotensin 2, lead to vasoconstriction, the vicious cycle, and as well as the release of renin and activation of the renin angiotensin system with the release of aldosterone and sodium retention. One of the measures to have hypertension post-transplantation is acute rejection. Acute rejection has a significant correlation between hypertension post-transplant and the risk of for acute rejection independent of graft function was found. Acute rejection was associated with higher levels of systolic blood pressure and lower diastolic blood pressure post transplantation. Higher blood pressure levels also were associated with earlier episodes of acute rejection. In multivariate analysis, acute rejection was associated significantly with systolic hypertension. Increased blood pressure is associated with acute rejection. So both is associated with each other. I would like to show you one of our recent publications about using power Doppler to differentiate between acute rejection and ATN and the different degrees of acute rejection. In the first, this is the picture of the first figure. Here it is a normal sonographic appearance of graft, which appear as well with borderline rejection and ATN. So we cannot differentiate by the power Doppler in such a situation. But when we go to grade 1 and 2 of acute rejection, we can see here the hyperperfusion of the cortex and the batchy perfusion of the parenchyma. And in grade 3, it is hard to see the perfusion by the power Doppler. The kidney looks hyperperfused or batch perfused like here, but with loss of diastolic wave. So we have the systolic wave and the diastolic wave like here, but here is the diastolic wave disappeared. This has been proved by CT angiography, and here is a normal picture of the grafted kidney, but this with acute severe rejection. So we use now the power Doppler DALE for the early follow-up of all the transplant recipients in the first 14 days in Mansoura. This is a histopathological picture of acute rejection. We have normally we have a lot of cellular infiltrates, the dark dots, and some of the tubular necrosis attenuation, and also there is an it is not shown here, but there is glomerular filtration in other cases. If it is antibody mediated, we have C4D fluorescence positive in the stained slide. As well as transplant glomerulopathy proved to be associated with hypertension, and here we can see the pathology. We can see the double contour of the glomeruli by light microscopy, as well as in the electron microscopy. We can see the widening of the subendothelial aspect of the capillary wall. So what is the impact of hypertension on graft survival? From an old publication from our center on the 2001, we have a significant drop of the graft survival in the newly developed hypertension in this curve. So it is dropping like this compared to the normal intensive one. And in a recent publication, last year, we can see the five-year survival in a comparison between the normotensive sustained hypertension and the newly developed hypertension post-transplantation. So we can see that there is no difference at the five-year, around 85%, but on the 10-year survival, there is marked difference from 75%. From those who were normotensive post-transplant compared to the newly developed hypertension 56. From another research that shows the impact of hypertension on the not only on graft survival but on the cardiovascular accident. And here this is the major causes of cardiovascular mortality in general, post-transplantation, and the cardiovascular is around 37%. And the graft survival, according to the systolic hypertension, we can see the dropping with the systolic more than 180, and it is much better survival when it's less than 120. As well as comparison as regards the age, so younger the age is much better the less incidence of cardiovascular accidents with more controlled systolic blood pressure compared to the old age. And also from a recent publication, a little bit old, it is showing the improved long-term outcome after renal transplantation associated with blood pressure control. However, it is still debatable how much can we control the blood pressure and what is the target. So many antihypertensive medications have been introduced to control blood pressure after transplantation. The first drug of choice is the calcium channel blocker. They are effectively counteract the afferent arteriolar vasoconstriction caused by the calcineurins, suggested the mechanism of progression of allograft dysfunction. The use of calcium channel blockers with calcineurin specialist dihydropyridine lead to a reduction in both delayed graft function and acute rejection episodes, and possibly also a better long-term graft function. They have a significant nephroprotective effect independent of the agent of antihypertensive action. They are relatively well tolerated. Concurrent administration of calcineurin and both non-dihydropyridine, as example, verapamil and diltiazem, can lead to increase the level of calcineurin and interaction with the calcineurin level, so can they cause nephrotoxicity. What about the ACE and the ARB? Known to slow down the progression of chronic renal disease, the possible mechanism is through the decrease in the intracapillary pressure, reduction in the permeability, selectivity, and alteration in the function of the mesangial cell, interference with the angiotensin-mediated generation of free radical formation. Both ACE and ARB may inhibit the activation of transforming growth factor beta 1, and however, the ability of ACE and ARB to slow the progression of chronic allograft dysfunction still remains unproved. All of this made the introduction of ACE and ARB to be delayed after renal transplantation. The administration of ACE and ARB has been considered safe recently during the later course of kidney transplantation, but it's a bit acute renal failure, delayed graft function when used early after transplantation in the presence of high doses of calcineurin. The blockade of RAS may have a beneficial effect on post-transplant kidney function because there is evidence that excess RAS activity in both the kidney donor and the recipient are important contributors to the pathogenesis of delayed graft function. Meta-analysis of randomized double-blind studies determined that they reserve left ventricular hypertrophy to a significantly greater degree than do beta blockers or diuretics. Losartan was more effective in the prevention of cardiovascular morbidity and death than atenolol for a similar reduction in mortality. And in this study, there is a head-to-head comparison between the nifedipine and lisinopril as regards the effect of post-transplantation on GFR, and we can see that GFR is a little bit lower with lisinopril at 3 weeks, 1 year, and 2 year follow-up of the patient. The latest Keidoki guidelines, which is based on evidence-based, have been classified the renal transplant recipient into the different categories of the CKD. Those with increased risk, they have all progressed to chronic allograft nephropathy, suffered from drug toxicity, however, cyclosporine or tacrolimus. They have glomerular recurrent disease from the kidneys and transplant glomerular disease, or they have glomerulopathy. For stage 1 to do kidney damage, they have hypertension, proteinuria, stages 3 and 4 with decreased GFR. They have complication from hypertension, and stage 5 is in the stage with cardiovascular disease and urine. The recommendation for hypertension came through that combination with ACE and nifedipine, especially lisinopril and nifedipine, have the much better improvement than using each separately, as shown in the first one here. Lisinopril and plus placebo, quinipril and plus ateno, the patient progressed from non-nephrotic range of proteinuria to nephrotic range of proteinuria. Lisinopril plus nifedipine was okay. Lisinopril, nifedipine plus placebo, still the patient still proteinuria. Another research from our center shows the effect of angiotensin receptor blocker, beneficial effect not only on controlling the blood pressure, but also to decrease the plasma levels of TGF beta 1 and interstitial fibrosis in our recipients. Another study shows the renoprotective effect of early inhibition of the renin angiotensin system in renal transplantation. So they have renoprotective effect when used in patients with good stable renal function and mild proteinuria, and may play a role to prevent the chronic allograft nephropathy. In this study, they show, by using the MDRD scoring system, the clearance 12 months before to 6 months after the initiation of the direct angiotensin receptor blocker. And we can see here the renal function as regards the clearance haven't that much changed. And we have to consider as well as the normal vascular physiology of hypertension, we are in a situation of transplantation. We also always put our mind to direct it toward the rejection. So recently, there is a study showing that there is antibodies against angiotensin 2 type 1 receptor, and those antibodies can initiate rejection. And that study that is published in New England Journal of Medicine in 2005 and followed by many other studies, 33 kidney transplant recipients who had refractory vascular rejection, they were also 13 of them had donor-specific anti-HLA antibodies, and 20 did not have anti-HLA antibodies. That is, we search about them normally for rejection, but they have malignant hypertension, and 16 of those were without anti-HLA antibodies, but with anti-type 1 receptor angiotensin 2. Some of them activating the IgG antibodies targeting the 81 receptor detected in the serum, and the 81 angiotensin losartan blocked agonistic 81 receptor antibody mediated effects, and basically antibody transfer induced the vasculopathy and hypertension in red kidney transplantation model. So when they transferred serum from this patient to a red model, they developed hypertension. So in conclusion, the non-HLA 81 receptor mediated pathway may contribute to refractory vascular rejection, and affected patients might benefit from removal of 81 receptor antibodies or from pharmacologic blockade of 81 receptor. So this may explain the chronic allograft nephropathy can slow down with the use of ACE and ARB. They are better than calcium channel blockers in protection against chronic allograft injury. They decrease the TGF beta production, decrease allograft injury as well, and the RAS blockade prevent or slow down progression of chronic renal damage still under investigation. What about the beta blockers? They reduce morbidity, mortality after myocardial infarction, are also of benefit in the management of heart failure, not only in the general population, but also in patients with kidney disease. Could be considered as a possible first-line therapy for both the transplant hypertension patients with concomitant coronary heart disease, have an adverse lipid profile, have been associated with increased risk for new-onset diabetes, have a potential limitation in patients receiving CNI, target of rapamycin, TOR inhibitors and or corticosteroids because of the hyperlipidemia. Newer third-generation beta blockers, like carbidolol, have been shown to have a neutral or positive effect on dyslipidemia and insulin resistance. So in summary, arterial hypertension plays a major role in the progression to chronic allograft failure and in morbidity and mortality associated with cardiovascular disease. Its prevalence varies with the type of immune suppressive regimen, time after transplantation and other interacting factors. Steroid sparing protocols and the calciumurine sparing protocols have been shown to improve blood pressure control and to reduce cardiovascular risk factors with low rates of allograft rejection and graft loss, particularly with concomitant use of low-dose calciumurine plus TOR inhibitors. the available data do not support the recommendation of any class of antihypertensive medications as preferred agents for long-term therapy to slow down the progression of kidney disease. Calcium channel blockers, ASR, diuretics, beta blockers continue to have a role despite the concern of risk for acute renal failure, hyperkalemia, post-transplantation anemia. ASRs are now considered valuable drugs for the transplant population. However, the ability of ASR to slow the progression of chronic allograft dysfunction remains unproven at the present time. Thank you very much.
شكرا طبعا لعرض الكفايه والادمنستريتف والادمنستريتف واعتقد لا كفايه اسئله يا احمد اسئله يا احمد عدد من الاسئله يعني على الناس فيها بالمحاضره تماما يعني هو طبعا اتفضل يا دكتور نايف
هو بس لا
المايك الدنيا
بليز والسيارة كريات انكريزين يعني اصبحتوا وكنتوا اصحاب ايه البريكوشن بتاعتك لما تيجي تستخدم الاي ار بيز او بيز الهيبوز دي زي الجنرال براكتس بتاع الكورجي ولا هنا في سيرتن اذر بريكوشن
هو مبدئيا لو هستخدمه في الريجكشن عشان الاي تي 1 يبقى لازم يكون عندي تيست للاي تي 1 ريسبتور انلايكلي انه يبقى الكريات بيعلى في اكيوت ريجكشن وانا ابدا مايندد ان انا استخدم الايس مبدئيا هبدا اعمل فول انفستيجيشن لكل البوسبل كوزز اوف اكيوت ريجكشن واذا ما النون انفيسيف ميثودولوجي ما جابتش نتيجه لازم اعمل رينال بايوبسي واشوف التايب اوف ريجكشن وبناء عليه انا ممكن ايفن وان اوف ذا بوسبل ثيرابيز ويل بي ذا بوتس ستيرويد البريكوشنز هي نفس البريكوشنز مع الجنرال سبيليشن وبناخد كمان البريكوشن زياده شويه ان احنا بنشتغل على الدراسه الكدني which is single وطبعا بنعمل دوبلر اسسمنت قبل ما نبدا العلاج ولازم نمشي مع الايكو وي هاف تو ستارت اس انهبيتور والمونيتور كرياتين ديلي with any more than 20% or 0.2% increment will stop the medication.
أنا أعتقد المحاضرة كانت ممتازة وكريتيف وكومبرهنسيف شكرا لك رحمة الله المحاضرة.